Well, I figured today would be a good time to get some words in on Biden's cognitive decline. It occurred to me, as I've been hearing a lot of people talk more and more about this, that it's not something I've directly addressed on this channel. And frankly, I've always thought that there were more pressing matters to focus on than that. But I think that as Biden is president for longer, it will become more and more of an issue for ordinary people. And while personally his cognitive decline is really more of it's more of a personal interest kind of story, as far as I'm concerned, I don't think it really affects the world too much. But because of that, I think that it also is quite it can be quite illustrative. For the ordinary person, for the normie, if you will, to see how someone like Joe Biden, who is so clearly not all there mentally, is somehow still able to be propped up as the President of the United States. There's this growing understanding in America that Joe Biden can't really be in charge. He can't, there must be people behind him. There must be folks like Kamala Harris. Oh, see, she must be the real power behind the throne, or somebody else, or maybe his wife, like in the case of Woodrow Wilson. But Joe Biden, no, well, he's not running the country. And it's true. Now, I don't think that it's true necessarily that Kamala Harris is the real power behind the throne. Frankly, every U.S. president in my lifetime has been, nothing but a figurehead, essentially. The President of the United States is someone who sits atop a massive bureaucracy, which really, acts in its own self-interest and does as it pleases, no matter who the president happens to be. You have folks in the bureaucratic state. From all different parts of the executive branch who come to the president day after day, and they present in front of him, choices, and they essentially tell him what he's going to do, what papers he needs to sign to authorize whatever it is they want to do. And those bureaucratic agencies, of course, are almost always controlled by special interest groups because it is special interest groups who oversee the creation of these bureaucratic agencies. A classic example of this would be the Federal Trade Commission, which was created supposedly to regulate the railroad industry because of all this cutthroat competition. Oh, it was such extreme capitalism, the railroads back in the 19th century. Yet, who was it that staffed the Federal Trade Commission, which regulated the railroads? Well, it was all ex-railroad company hacks. It was people who were going to do the bidding of the railroad industry. And so all it was a power play on the part of certain interests in the railroad industry, in shipping, to try and gain a stranglehold on the market and use the government to further their own business interests. And that same story repeats itself in almost every case when it comes to American governance, and particularly the executive branch of the U.S. federal government. There are powerful people who have a lot of influence over our government, and each one of them wants to make sure that their little pet project is well funded and is being carried out by the federal government. And so it's the interplay, the interaction between these various different interest groups, and their relative strengths and their leverage over the federal government that determines really what the actions of the federal government will be. And so that's bigger than any one man, obviously. And no, because of this, no one man can have a majority stake or majority control over what's going on with the federal government. And so that's why the establishment, when they put up Joe Biden to be elected, they knew that he was not all there. But frankly, they didn't care because they knew they didn't need him to be all there. They just need him to smile and wave. They need him to sit behind a desk and look like he's doing something productive. His job is to play a character on TV. His job isn't to actually lead the U.S. government. The U.S. government, as I explained, is led by a whole, you know, a very shadowy cabal of people who aren't necessarily aligned with one another, but who each have specific interests that they are, you know, seeking to accomplish. And really, both Trump and Biden were very good at illustrating this for ordinary people. Because when Trump got in there, and he has a very strong personality, he had very strong opinions about what he wanted to get done when he got in there, and all of a sudden his supporters could see, wow, he's not able to get anything done in there, he's getting totally stonewalled, people started to realize, oh, there's this thing called a deep state, which people had varying levels of, you know, of correct understanding about, but, you know, the general principle is that, you know, the president doesn't really have control over everything. There's a lot of people who are already there, and generally they have more say than the president, and if the president goes against the administrative state and what its interests are, you know, he's not going to win. And so when you combine that with, you know, the very strong presence of Donald Trump being unable to accomplish his goals, being unable to control the federal government, if you combine that with the weakness, the obvious weakness of Joe Biden, and his seeming ability to, you know, keep things under control, and by that I mean there's not a bunch of erratic orders being issued. You don't have planes falling out of the sky. You don't have the federal government ceasing to function just because the man at the top of the pyramid is not all there. And so it's useful for people to witness this and to start to understand, you know, the implications of this reality. I think that, you know, if, you know, when talking to people about this issue, you know, it's a great opportunity to try and educate them and, you know, about things that otherwise they would have trouble believing. Like when Bush or Obama were in there, or Clinton or somebody like that, you know, they'd go, no, what are you talking about? Of course, the president's in charge. You know, he makes all these decisions. And whether I disagree with them or not, you know, they're his decisions. But in Biden's case, it's clear and obvious to just about anyone that he's not calling the shots. And so then, if you make a good case as to who, in all likelihood, is calling the shots, you have a much better chance of persuading people. Because the fact of the matter is that all these presidents were figureheads. It's just that Trump and Biden are particularly poor at serving as figureheads for the administrative state. In Trump's case, it was because he didn't know that he was supposed to be a figurehead. Trump got in and thought he actually would be in charge. You know, big mistake that he made. And Biden, in that case, he's a poor figurehead because he just lacks the ability at this point. So that's about all I have to say on this matter for now. So I guess I'll see you folks back here tomorrow.